This is evolution simulation game The Sapling, my solo indie game project. It lets you design your own plants and animals, put them in an ecosystem together, and see how they evolve. This is the third video in a series of 6 weekly devlogs to show you the next big update I am currently working on. So far in the game, there are only 2 real niches to fill. The plant eater niche and the nectar eater niche. Theoretically, there was also the meat eater niche, but in practice it was really hard to keep a stable population. The upcoming big update will make the number of possible niches many times larger. The first thing to be added to increase the number of niches is body size, so you can now have niches like small meat eaters or large plant eaters. Instead of one small body size, you now get 4, for both plants and animals. If the only difference between a child species and an ancestor species is its size, this will also be reflected in the species name, which can now contain adjectives like greater or lesser. For plants, having greater species means you can now have massive forests. Body sizes also influence life expectancy. The larger a plant is, the more likely it is to grow older. Older plants are also a bit of a relief for the CPU. So far, plants showing up and dying again meant the game needed to constantly generate new 3D models on the fly. If plants can get older, the same model can be used for a longer period of time. By the way, if you would like to know more about what I did to optimize the game so it can have so many animated organisms on screen at the same time, I have written a blog post about it, including some interactive parts for you to better understand how the system works. The link is below. Growing larger requires more resources, so it cannot be done everywhere, but if possible, it is a great strategy to increase the chances of survival. For example, larger plants no longer instantly die when animals take a bite out of them, and it is also easier to have all edible body parts out of reach. If the animals don't have long necks, that is. Besides growing long necks, animals can of course also evolve to get larger. Fun fact, in the animal editor I cheat by making the stage smaller instead of the animal larger. For animals too, an important reason to get larger is that you simply get more health points, and like plants, large animals live longer. However, just as is the case for most large animals in real life, they will also be pregnant for a longer period of time. This longer pregnancy period is a risk. The longer an embryo is inside the mother, the larger the chance that the mother will die during the pregnancy. Also, it means that the mother needs more time per baby and thus has fewer offspring. There are 2 strategies to make pregnancies shorter again. The first one is related to which body parts you choose. Each body part now has a statistic indicating what it will add to the pregnancy time. Among body parts that take really long are mouths with a lot of teeth. This relation between pregnancy time and mouths has the side advantage that it makes creatures with multiple mouths less overpowered. So far in random mutations mode, often animals just evolved multiple mouths so they could eat everything. There is now a real incentive to lose body parts that are not crucial for survival. If pregnancy time is really an issue in a particular ecosystem, it will also be possible to evolve powerful mouths with no teeth at all. Beaks. This is an intermediary stage. And these are the beaks for plants, nectar, and meat. The other solution to long pregnancy times will be to not have the embryo develop inside the mother's body at all, but in an egg. In fact, eggs will be the default when you start a new scenario, and you can gradually change the animal so the egg stays longer and longer inside the body. Eggs will be visible in the landscape. And if you zoom in close, you get to see this hatch animation, which was a lot of fun to make in Blender. And the addition of eggs brings us to meat eaters, because the meat eater niche has suddenly become a lot more interesting. I have added this mouth to celebrate. Before, if a carnivore was close to another animal, it played the eat animation and the other animal would simply disappear, eaten as a whole. While this mechanic is still in the game, it is only possible if the predator is a lot larger than its prey now, or if the prey is still a child. A strategy for smaller predators could instead be to focus on any eggs laying around unprotected. There is now a new instinct option, so predators using this strategy actively look for and go to eggs. For prey animals, in turn, this is an extra incentive to change their bodies so they need to stay in their eggs shorter. This whole interaction between meat eaters, body size, children and eggs hopefully sounds straightforward, but it was actually surprisingly hard to get right. You don't only have to worry about which size can eat which, but also which size can eat which eggs, and children. And the predators themselves can also be children. So, complicated. Besides eating eggs, another strategy for meat eaters can be to attack and kill their prey. There is now a whole new instinct to attack other animals close to you, and a new instinct to respond to pain. If an animal dies because of an attack, it will drop carrion that can be eaten by the predators. Animals that die of natural causes will also drop carrion, allowing for a simple scavenger system as well. Obviously, meat-eater mouths with a lot of sharp teeth will give more attack power, but I have also added powerful plant-eater mouths and a whole range of horns. Besides offense, attacking anything that comes close can of course also be used as a defensive strategy to avoid being eaten. And the same defense system is now also available for plants, who can now evolve thorns, spines and prickles to defend themselves. With the whole instinct system getting more complicated and important, I figured it should be way more transparent when it is really active in the simulation. To achieve this, when you zoom in on an animal, you now see a list of instincts on the left and which one is active. Hopefully you now think to yourself that this is a really simple and clear design, because it took me so many iterations to get it this simple. This is really the true irony of UI design. The less you see on screen, the harder it was to get it that way. With all these new interactions between predators and prey, sensing other animals of course also becomes much more important. As existing players might have recognized, I have added all kinds of new eyes and ears, and added an extra statistic to eyes to determine their field of view. Well, for example, these eyes might be able to look very far into the distance. These eyes have a very wide field of view. And this again can be visualized when zooming in on an animal, so you can understand much better what it sees and hears and why it responds the way it does. Okay, so I can imagine this devlog has been a lot to take in. And perhaps surprisingly, all of these new features, so the body sizes, the expected ages, pregnancy times, eggs, attacking, defending, senses, they are not even really what I wanted to show you. Instead, it's that all these features are connected. They all work together, blend together, into one ecosystem, allowing you, the player, to create or watch emerge a much richer world. If this video made you want to try the game, you can. It is currently available in early access on Steam and itch. See the links below for more information. Keep in mind though that what you just saw in this video will be part of the next big update, which is currently planned for June 15. If you want to follow development, there is a Twitter and a newsletter. And you might also be interested in other videos on this channel, like the one where I run the simulation for 7 days straight, or the trailer for the previous flower update.